I could take us through an article explaining who RFK Jr. is, but I feel like, Julian, you guys have done enough research on him to sort of tell us who the hell he is, and I will play a clip from one of his speeches.
Well, I mean, clearly, he's the son of political royalty in the United States. He is a former law school professor. He was an environmental lawyer for many years. He really established a solid reputation as someone who was doing that kind of work, going after corporations and government in terms of their offenses against the environment and pollution and that sort of thing. And then around 2005, he started to be swayed by anti-vax arguments. And by 2016, he had founded the Children's Defense Fund, I believe it's Children's Health Defense is the name of the organization. Yeah. And by 2019, he was one of the two biggest spenders on anti-vax ads on Facebook. And it's
2018?
Been rolling by 2019, I believe.
Oh, that's fun. So after we realized Facebook said they were going to change.
Yeah, that's part of why we have that data, right? Was because there was increasing scrutiny on like what's actually going on here. How is big tech profiting from this misinformation, and who are the people who are giving them the money? And it turned out RFK Jr. was one of the two biggest spenders in that regard.
That's crazy. That 180 is so sad and bizarre.
Well, it's interesting. You know, you can see how if we assume that he's sincere. Right, which I like to do. You can see how the transition from being opposed to pollution of the external environment could translate in an emotional sense into the sort of symbolism of protecting innocent children against their bloodstreams being polluted by vaccines. And he bought into the whole idea that the MMR vaccine was causing autism and became a mouthpiece for that. He became sort of aligned with Andrew Wakefield, who started that off and later admitted that he made all of that up after he had his medical license stripped. Yeah.
Good shit. He wants to run for president. This was him actually at an anti-mandate rally in DC. This is some fun stuff. And obviously his voice is the voice of a Kennedy. I mean, it's or a chain smoker or a little bit of both. Is it an affectation, Julian? Is he putting it on?
No, he has a condition that makes his voice sound like that. It's called dysphonia, I believe.
Okay. All right. Yeah,
but that's on top of the blue blood, you know, pronunciation and cadence.
Indeed. Yeah. All right. Here he is.
Within 5 years, we're going to see 415,000 low orbit satellites. Bill Gates says his 65,000 satellites alone will be able to look at every square inch of the planet 24 hours a day. They're putting in 5G to harvest our data and control our behavior. Digital currency that will allow them to punish us from a distance and cut off our food supply. Vaccine passports. The minute they hand you that vaccine passport, every right that you have is transformed into a privilege contingent upon your obedience to arbitrary government dictates. It will make you a slave.
Shoots at the screen. There he is.
I mean, this is incredible. This is conspiracy theory bingo, right? He hit like 5-6 different outlandish claims about what's going on. In that same speech, he calls it turnkey totalitarianism. And it all centers on how COVID quarantine measures and vaccines are part of this plot to take away your freedom and impose authoritarian control over every aspect of your life. And Bill Gates, by the way, has thousands of satellites and drones that are going to be surveilling us at all times. Wow.
Yeah, he loves to harp on Bill Gates. Mm-hmm. And I do think it's interesting. They're going to control your every, you know, the 5G is going to control your every motion or move or like your thoughts. And it's like, just like how I bought a bunch of Facebook ads to tell you about how vaccines are evil.
Yeah, and that's about as literal of a tinfoil hat conspiracy as you can get. You got to protect your brain from the 5G because it's coming and it's going to control you. And it's in that same speech in front of you know, a few thousand people at the Lincoln Memorial. It's really stunning to see him standing in front of an American flag, behind an American, in front of an American flag, and behind all of that is the statue of Lincoln, so iconic. And in that same speech, he says, he compares Americans wanting to not be vaccinated against COVID to Anne Frank, and says that it was easier for Anne Frank to escape the Nazis than it would be for Americans to escape the surveillance state that Bill Gates is setting up. And spoiler alert, Anne Frank did not escape the fucking Nazis.
Yes,
That's kind of why her story survived, actually.
Yeah, yeah. Sure, we didn't take away what we should have taken away from the Anne Frank story. That is, I mean, first of all, obviously, I gotta, what is it, the law that you have to compare everything to Nazism?
Yeah. Godwin's, I think.
Right, even though that's should be our shit, because that's what it is. Now, here's the scary part. He's not actually polling that bad. Mm-hmm. He is polling at 19%. This is an article that compares him to Ron DeSantis, who's also just polling at 21%. Why? Julian, please explain this.
Well, it's very interesting. First of all, he has name recognition, so we can't sort of sell that short. Second of all, Biden, you know, Biden doesn't really evoke a lot of enthusiasm. So people are interested in who else may be available. And I know there are plenty of progressive voices saying we need someone else who's going to, you know, really get in there with a good progressive agenda and enact it courageously. But there's another piece here, which is that I think we live in a time of populist appeal, where someone who is coming from the outside, again, here's another outsider, just like Trump was an outsider, right? A man of the people. You have someone coming from outside of mainstream politics, shall we say, with we call it on the podcast, forbidden knowledge or stigmatized knowledge, right? And this is where you get an interesting, our podcast is called Conspirituality. You get this interesting overlap between conspiracy theories and more sort of spiritual claims that I would put like alternative medicine in that camp, kind of, right? Because there's a sort of magical sense about how alternative medicine is supposed to work. Stigmatized knowledge is any knowledge that has been rejected by mainstream authority, by science, and perhaps by the political mainstream. So you have a figure like this who can come along, who has soaring rhetoric, and who is you know, saying all of the things that a lot of people want to hear about how COVID was mishandled, about how Fauci really should be prosecuted, about how we don't know what's in those vaccines, and I'm being censored. And the Twitter files show that, you know, government and big tech were colluding with university think tanks to censor all sorts of voices, and we should stand up against that. So he has a lot of that momentum going for him. But here's the wild thing. Reporting just this past Friday on NBC essentially gave him what I call the royal straight flush poker hand of endorsements here. He got Steve Bannon, Roger Stone, Mike Flynn, Alex Jones, and Charlie Kirk, all basically saying he's an anti-globalist, he's a populist, he's a man of integrity. Alex Jones says he campaigns against those poisonous shots. They're all in favor of him because he opposes U.S. support for Ukraine.
Damn.
Charlie Kirk said it would be a dream ticket if he became Trump's running mate. So yeah, these are not good signs, but you see how this weird kind of populist overlap between right and left can start to happen.
Yeah, and is he... Because I don't know much about his history with Bannon, but I have read, and I don't know if it's true, that Bannon's been trying to recruit RFK Jr. to run for president for a while. Do you know any more about his Bannon connection?
I don't, actually. All I saw was just this recent glowing kind of endorsement that Bannon did on his show. But it doesn't surprise me. I mean, Bannon is deeply networked with a group of people who really do want to move America closer and closer to something like Orbán's Hungary. Mm-hmm. And, you know, this is not a conspiracy theory. Bannon hosts gala dinners around the world where he invites far-right leaders from multiple different countries, some of whom are well-known, like Orbán, Duterte, who was the guy in the Philippines? In Brazil. I'm forgetting his name.
Bolsonaro.
Yeah. So
Le Pen in France.
Yeah. He's formed all of those kinds of alliances. And it doesn't surprise me that he would see RFK Jr. as a useful pawn in that kind of game, whether it's to sow chaos on the left or it's to create some kind of weird red-brown alliance, as you alluded to last time we talked.
I know. And last time we talked, by the way, again, was about Marianne Williamson, who has her own angle on this. And I just, John, I wanted you to jump in here because I wanted your thoughts on, you know, these candidates who sometimes say the progressive thing, say the thing that feels like we would otherwise agree with them. So here's RFK Jr. yesterday tweeting, between October 2021 and September 2022, the U.S. spent $877 billion on the military, more than the next 10 countries combined. These huge military expenditures, along with the rising cost of a for-profit healthcare system, have driven the U.S. national debt over $31 trillion, nearly $5 trillion more. So again, we don't necessarily go there on the debt because it's not the number one thing on our minds or anyone's minds, but he's hammering the for-profit healthcare industry, he's hammering the military budget, and yet he's a rabid anti-vaxxer, doesn't believe in any pharma, to say nothing of big pharma. I don't know, what does that say about, like, the left and just, like, you know, electoral politics generally?
So I don't know him, so I don't know to what extent he's reflecting his deeply founded actual beliefs. That we've had other examples of this that I think we can probably think of pretty easily, that clearly they are chasing right-wing money. Like, we know that. Basically, what the right wants at all times is people with some credibility on the left to perhaps wholly get rid of whatever positions they had, or perhaps, as you're seeing with him, still, you know, speak out against military spending or big pharma or whatever to maintain a little bit of plausible deniability about what the state of your ideology actually is. And then direct all of this, I think, well-founded concern about things like the degradation of the environment, the lies of pharmaceuticals, the spending on the military, but only ever against Democrats transgressing on those things. Mm-hmm. Like, take all those concerns and never apply them to the Republicans who will get elected if you follow my political strategy.
Yep.
And then, oh yeah, well, let Trump get elected and military spending will definitely go down then. We won't be, you know, engaging in any, you know, wars in, you know, Yemen or anything. And so it's like, it's a weaponizing of people who are honest, but haven't been well-trained necessarily by the American education system to think critically, do their own research, who have, I think, a justifiable suspicion of mainstream media. And so they don't trust most, you know, sort of mainstream sources of information. Mm-hmm. They're primed to believe that this stigmatized, forbidden knowledge that they're being given is special because it's coming from someone who says that they're, you know, being shut out and all that. You combine all of these things and every bit of it is understandable. Especially the stakes, like, people are going to freak out if they think that kids' lives are on the line, if they believe that pharmaceutical companies have lied to them. But when you just combine all of these things, it just has potentially horrific outcomes that can be weaponized by people who have a vested interest in maintaining the status quo.
Yeah. And I actually have to say, though, I have to lay the blame on the Democratic Party again. And it's not on some, like, that's why we must abandon Democratic Party. No, but it's on the leadership to have left such a vacuum, and the fact that we have, you know, the party has strayed so far from any sort of FDR goals, right, has become such a corporatist party, that the lane of saying we spend too much on the military and not enough on actually what helps children, which is education and access or guaranteed healthcare. What actually helps us here is safe housing and whatnot, and not an over policing, et cetera, et cetera. Like, they have no line. They have no line. And so you get, you know, they spend years saying Bernie's not really a Democrat. Fuck Bernie. Stop coming for our shit. When Bernie's the best thing that ever happened to, like, any kind of, you know, let's say left of Hillary politics in you know, years, and you leave the lane open for what? For Donald Trump to pick up that Bernie mantle and just echo the populist message, literally say things like, you know, the establishment, which is now, when you say the establishment, you just sound like a right winger, right? Mm-hmm. You mostly sound like a right winger. Mainstream media, you sound like a right winger because fucking Tucker Carlson says that. So it makes me mad because it makes me feel like there is no leadership, and there's no, not only there's no leadership from the Democratic Party, but fundamentally there is no politics for them to even want to take up that mantle because they don't stand for anything. So anyway, but yeah, I mean, it's Julian, Bannon, Alex Jones, Charlie Kirk, I did a double take because RFK Jr. is running for the Democratic primary nomination. Why? Explain that.
Yeah, some of it may be that they want to create chaos on the left, and so they're like, "Oh yeah, this is great. You know, we're gonna throw our weight behind this guy." Some of it is that they see that he might be someone who they can flip in some way. Maybe becomes an independent, and that splits the vote on the left. Maybe he goes, "I'm gonna partner with Trump," and he makes some kind of, you know, rationalizing argument. I don't know. I don't think this would happen, but in that scenario, that he would make some kind of rationalizing argument that he could. He could have a good effect on Trump, and together they could do wonderful things for the true people in the heartland of America. But, you know, when we look at Kennedy and we look at Williamson, and you brought up Tulsi, there's a way that they're each maybe in perhaps in different ways emblematic of a kind of a lack of ideological kind of rootedness, a lack of political education, a lack of experience in terms of how politics works, and perhaps a naivete. You know, Kennedy in March sat down for a 2-hour American thought leaders interview with Epoch Times. So, you know, he's willing to give Epoch Times 2 hours and a video that you have to click through from an old YouTube excerpt to go and watch the whole things to Epoch Times and give them your email. I mean, I don't think
this
he knows.
This is the Falun Gong, by the way, right? Yeah. This is their movement. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Their paper.
So if there's that kind of naivete,
I'm going to end up working for the Epoch Times the way my career is going. Epoch Times is going to. I would never work for the Epoch Times.
Either that or Russia Today.
Wow. No, they wouldn't hire me. I tried. No, I would. but yeah, no, that. You're right, exactly. And of course, a profound sense of ego, which you have to have, I think, no matter what, if you're running for president.
And I mean, for all of those people that we listed that were surprised are saying positive things about him. What they have in common with him is the COVID denialism, anti-quarantine measures, anti-vaccine. The globalists are coming for us. They want to take away our guns. They want to take away our national identity. Well, maybe the national identity piece they don't have in common with him, but it's still that libertarian sense that somehow your sovereign freedoms are being imposed upon. And that's where there is this overlap with what we cover on the podcast in terms of the more kind of spiritual wellness alternative medicine community, is that there's a strong sense of like, don't tell me what to do with my body.
Right. I mean, what's so fucked, right? And the pandemic turbocharged this, and that's why your podcast is so great, right? Is that, again, back to, you know, laying the blame at the feet of the Democrats for not taking up these mantles. I also, you know, the blame of the mistrust in healthcare and the pharmaceutical industry, allowing them to get away with charging us any price,
absolutely,
allowing them to hurt us, to, you know, obviously lead to massive, you know, epidemics and addiction, but then also the lack of access to healthcare and the fact that people can't pay for it. And, you know, remember that TikTok, John, from the pandemic, or maybe Julian, you saw it too, where it was like, a woman was like, if the vaccine is, you know, so great, then how come they're giving away for free? You know, why doesn't it cost anything? And you're like, good point, honey. You're so close, right? You're so close to, like, you're almost a Medicare for all person. You're just missing this one thing.
Yeah. I mean, you're describing really well the conditions of unregulated rapacious capitalism and people having no social safety net, in which a certain kind of populism and conspiratorial mindset can be exploited by people who want to do so.
Yes. Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. Can I also throw in too, this is sort of carrying on from your talk about sort of what the overlap would be between him and them, and this definite knee-jerk, like, how dare you tell me what to do thing, which is very much there, but also, like, it's a very specific demographic version of that. How dare you tell me, a white individual, male, generally, what to do? The rest of me, you can tell them to do whatever the hell you want. Like, like RFK might believe some stuff that I believe about the environment or whatever, and he definitely, in his rhetoric, will stress how your rights are being taken away. But he's also effectively telling people to ignore the way that people's rights are not hypothetically in the future being taken away by robots in the sky, but have been being taken away by legislation right now. It's just people that don't necessarily look like RFK, or perhaps some of the people in the audience. If you're, exactly. you know, your reproductive rights are being stripped away, if it's much harder for you to vote, if your representatives are being silenced, if you, your ability to, like, they're saying, don't you dare ask me to put a vaccine in my body. But if you're okay with the government banning gender affirming care when it comes to hormonal therapy,
yeah.
then you don't have the libertarian view that you seem to think you
do. Oh, totally. 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 And yeah. all this, we're in such an upside down world right now with all of this. You mentioned the book bannings earlier, all of this crying about censorship and then turn around and ban books. It's this ongoing, the takeover of New College in Florida by DeSantis and Chris Rufo, this whole sense that you're going to enact a set of actual draconian authoritarian measures in the name of trying to protect all of the constitutional rights we have that the woke mind virus is trying to take away from us. It's so crazy and so dishonest. And one of the disturbing things about Kennedy that we haven't touched on yet, and I wanted mm-hmm. to just piggyback on what you were saying, John, is, you know, he has used his political capital that comes from his family, especially with regards to the civil rights history, to make great inroads into African-American communities and into immigrant communities, Black and brown immigrant communities, and spread his anti-vaccine messages there. He's partnered with people like Tony Muhammad from Nation of Islam. He's partnered with Black Lives Matter leaders and with people who are African-Americans who are running for Senate to go in there and basically get the ball rolling on a lot of suspicion about vaccines. And it's led to some terrible things. In Samoa in 2019, he went to the American embassy there and was photographed with anti-vaccine activists. He wrote a letter to the president of Samoa and said, you really need to be suspicious about the MMR vaccine. Led to a measles outbreak. 5,700 people were infected. Wow. 83 people died. With Tony Muhammad, he co-produced a documentary called Medical Apartheid, which uses the Tuskegee syphilis study. He's not afraid to exploit actual medical atrocities
yes.
to try to then spread this false idea that Black and brown boys are more, especially boys, are more susceptible to severe vaccine side effects, but it's been covered up by the CDC. And to really try to campaign on this idea that he's standing up for people of color. It's appalling.
No, that's so, yeah, that's so insidious and awful. And no one's going to hold him accountable. And I think it's really interesting. Julian, you could tell me this. Have there been any women to capitalize on the vaccine and the fact that, like, actually one of the side effects of it in the COVID-19 vaccine was it made menstrual periods incredibly heavy?
Oh, like, so many.
There have been? Okay, good. So I was like, we need our like anti-vax women to like, yeah. you know, spout that.
Dr. Christiane Northrup is a major one. Kelly yes. Brogan, a former psychiatrist, Kelly Brogan is another one.
Northrup hasn't received, she hasn't gotten her period in how long? Come on.
yeah, but the idea was that this was being covered up. It was bad for women. You know, this is part of the crossover in terms of conspirituality is there's also a lot of this, the archetype of the sacred feminine, the sense that
yeah.
an earth goddess, and that really what's going to heal the world is if we go back to the earth and go back to what are sort of labeled as feminine principles, which you know, include a lot of this kind of misinformation. But with the mm-hmm. COVID vaccines, yes, there was this a lot of
people talked about the effects. Yeah.
Yeah. And a lot of fear mongering about how it was going to affect your baby or how you were not going to be able to get pregnant. And
oh,
then
my God.
Christiane Northrup even came up with this idea that if your partner had been vaccinated, you could get the spike proteins from them. There was like some kind of contagion from the spike proteins. And she actually said on her Instagram that women who had male partners who were getting vaccinated should refuse to have sex with them.
Jesus.
And that's yeah, no, how this, we're going to save the world.
And then dudes started selling their anti-vax cum. I mean, we're arguably in a better place now somehow, but also we've been forever, like, yes, marred by the anti-vax movement. Mm-hmm. And by the way, in terms of that sacred feminine stuff, please listen to the Marianne Williamson discussion, because I think it's true that there is something captivating about her kind of like hearkening to that feminine energy. And even it sort of like interests me and I'm like, oh, but anyway, any last words on Kennedy, Julian, before final thoughts on how much is this Q related? Is there any Q related stuff? I know the QAnon followers have been waiting under a bridge in Dallas for, you know, JFK Jr. to come back, or JFK himself. It's not clear.
Yeah.
Are they immediately attracted to RFK?
I haven't seen anything about that yet. I mean, I think the important thing that I always want to bear in mind when the topic of QAnon comes up is that QAnon is not like a political party. It's not like a group. It's not like the some kind of group that you can join and you all wear funny hats and you gather together for conventions, the Shriners or something, right?
It's not like MAGA.
No, it's not like MAGA. Yeah, it is this sort of morphing, evolving online phenomenon that cobbles together whatever conspiracy theories are speaking to the moment. And it's opportunistic. There's a whole group of influencers who became the people who were interpreting the Q drops and then selling merch off of that and then building their YouTube following before they get kicked off, some of them, off of that. And so there's a real, it's a digital religion, if you will. It's an opportunistic capitalist enterprise that relies on e-commerce. It is basically taking, if we consider that each time the media evolved into, going back to the printing press, each time it evolved to reach more people, there were always conspiracy theories that were being spread. And digital proliferation is just faster and more virulent than anything we've ever seen before. So, you know, will there be people who espouse the main sort of tenets of QAnon who end up wanting to ride on RFK Jr.'s coattails? Yeah, sure. But, you know, I wouldn't say like he's connected to QAnon in some kind of like shadowy
way. John, we've covered this, but like in the same way that like Marjorie Greene isn't Q, but like, and Trump isn't Q, but will play a song from them and definitely do a bunch of hat tips because it's a actual constituency.
They're happy to dog whistle to that constituency, often in ways that are audible to the rest of us, right?
What's going on, Frantifa? If you haven't already, subscribe to this channel right now. Hit that button. And also, you can become a patron and support the show every single week. Get access to bonus episodes and exclusive merchandise. Patreon.com/bituationroom. Do it.